In this section, we want to talk about types of graphs, specifically graphs that we can use to help visualize numerical data. So, data that can be ordered or ranked. The purpose of graphs, something just to keep in mind, is the idea that we construct graphs, specifically in statistics, to help make sense of information. So, if you were to imagine a data set, if it had 5 to 10 values, there might be some things that you could sort of intuitively understand by looking at those numbers. You could tell which numbers are occurring most frequently, if the numbers were all relatively large, or most were relatively small, if there was a wide variety. But when we started getting into larger and larger data sets, it becomes more complicated to look at a list of numbers and understand what that information means. So we want to create different types of graphs that help us take all of that data, turn it into a visual representation that we can make a little bit more sense of. So the first graph that we want to introduce is histograms. We want to take a look at some of the histograms below. That's data on police officer deaths in Midwestern and Northeastern states. And this data was accurate as of April 2012. It was the last time I collected this information. So what we have are actually four different graphs that all represent exactly the same information, just in slightly different ways. So we're going to take a look at each of these, talk about some of the similarities and differences, in general, just what a histogram is, and then we'll move on after that to talking about how we interpret histograms, how we construct them, things like that. So we have a title at the top telling us again this is about police officer deaths in these different states. Our x-axis represents the number of deaths. So these numbers represent the different data values. So a state might have had 400 deaths, 650 deaths. Those are the data values we collected. And then along the y-axis, we have the frequency, which is showing us how many states had that number of deaths. So 4 different states, 8 different states, 1 different state. And what we're doing with our data is grouping it into what we call classes or bins. We'll move back and forth between that language, but they mean the same thing. So our first class is from 0 to 200. So meaning any state that has their police officer deaths anywhere between 0 and 200 will be included in this first bin. Then the second bin is from 200 to 400. 400 to 600. So we're grouping lots of data into one bin or one class together. So a little more specifically, that tells us that in this first graph, we have a class width of 200 because each of these bins is 200 wide. So from 0 to 200, 200 to 400. We can also talk about class boundaries. So class boundaries just refer to the smallest and largest value in each class. So for the first class, the boundaries would be 0 to 200. For the second class, that would be 200 to 400, and so on, all the way up to this last class, which is 1200 to 1400. So we talk about the individual classes, we can talk about how wide they are, we can talk about the boundaries that dictate where our different data values will fall. And then we can also talk about the frequencies for each of these bins or each of these classes. So our last bin on the end here is going to have a frequency of 1, meaning there was one state that had between 1,200 and 1,400 police officer deaths. We've got a frequency of 1 for this class, 3, 2, 5, and 9. So that's the information that we can kind of read off of this chart or off this graph. And then the other piece is, even though there's no bar here, we do have a class from 1,000 to 1,200, meaning the frequency here would be 0. So that outlines the basic structure of what we see when we look at a histogram, just the real nuts and bolts approach, what's there. Pictured next to it, now what we have is a relative frequency histogram. A relative frequency histogram is identical to a histogram, except for one thing. Our y-axis is changing. So in the first graph, these were whole number values. 2, 4, 6, 8. Now we're changing to some decimal values. So originally, we were reporting the actual frequency. 9 different states had total police officer deaths between 0 and 200. Now we're changing this to be relative frequencies. So our 0.4, for instance, represents 40%. So instead of talking about absolute numbers, now we're talking about relative to all of the states we collected data on, a little over 40% had between 0 and 200 deaths. So a different way of representing that same information, but you'll notice that the shape of the graph, the number of bars, their heights, everything's identical except for what that y-axis represents. In our last two graphs, we're still looking at police officer deaths in these two sets of states, but now we see two very different pictures, different from each other and different from either of these first two graphs. So even though these graphs are using the exact same information, we have some different frequencies. In this case, a frequency of 15, 5, and that's probably 1 or 2, depending. Here we have frequencies of 6, 3, 2, 3, 1, 1, and 1, 2, 1, and 1. So each of our bars now has different frequencies. We have different shapes, different numbers of bars. And the reason for that is that we're changing in each of these graphs that class width. So in the original graph that we looked at, we had a class width of 200. Now for this graph, the class width has been increased to 500. So that first class, or first bin, now contains all states that have between 0 and 500 deaths, which means we're grouping more data into that same category, so that class is getting larger. In the last graph here, our class width was reduced to 100. So now what we see are more bins, and we start to see a different shape emerging for each of these graphs. So for instance, if we look at this third graph, if we think about sort of a curve connecting the center point of the tops of each of these bins, what we see in this example is a curve that would follow pretty much in just one general direction headed down. So we see this decreasing graph. In the first example, we start off with that same idea. We would see a decreasing graph for the first couple of bins. Then we would see a peak or a spike as we have a class that has a slightly higher frequency. And then that graph dips back down and then peaks back up again. In the last graph, we have something similar to that happening. We have our graph that's decreasing, picks back up a little bit, drops back down, picks up again, drops down, picks up again, drops down, and picks back up again. So if we just look at the tops of each of these bars, we see these different shapes depending on what we set our class width to be. And this is something important to keep in mind. We can change the appearance of data with histograms depending on the class width. So we can get something that decreases, has a point where it spikes back up, decreases and spikes back up again. The same data with a different class width simply just decreases across that entire range. And then we have this last graph with the smallest class width, and we have a lot more changes going on with that pattern kind of increasing, decreasing. So with histograms, two different pictures can you use to represent the exact same information. So something to always pay attention to is that class width that's being used. We can start to hide certain pieces of information. For instance, in the third graph and the first graph, we had at least one bar that was a little bit separate from the rest, so there's a little bit of a gap here. In this graph, we have continuous bars without any gaps. So there are certain characteristics of the graph that can be hidden or not revealed as well depending on that different class width. And we'll talk about what some of that information means.